I was keenly aware that today is April 1st, which we all know is April Fool's Day. I even got an inadvertent April Fool's Day joke on myself, running out to the restroom shortly before. I left all of the notes for my talk down there, so if you think it's rambling now, it could have just gotten a whole lot worse. But the thought did initially cross my mind to play kind of devil's advocate, you know, present something completely opposed to what I actually was thinking, and then say, April Fool's, but I kind of thought the better of that, you know, thinking that it could be rather confusing, and if quoted out of context, it could make for some pretty hysterical blackmail on my part. So, nevertheless, since it does kind of prove a good point, it's a time-honored tradition to kind of present your opponent's tact first, and then kind of spend the rest of your talk setting it straight. So here I'm going to put on my devil's advocate hat and say, music ought to be forbidden in the sacred liturgy. After all, it could be a frivolous distraction from the word of God and the sacraments. Furthermore, God wants to turn us away from the world of senses during worship and focus us purely on the spiritual world of God. God is spiritual and invisible, so we shouldn't sully our senses with that which is sensual. That said, if we're having trouble luring people into our churches and away from the evils of the outside world, I suppose we could admit music solely kind of as a form of entertainment to keep them happy in God's house. Now I take off my devil's advocate hat and return to myself. Most of us, at some point in our lives, have probably heard an argument rather similar to that. And while we might even think it to be Catholic teaching, it's actually quite at odds with Catholic ethos. So throughout this talk, I wish to kind of defend the importance of sacred music as an integral part of the liturgy. That means that the manner in which we practice it directly affects the manner in which we worship God, ergo, it also affects our relationship with God. Now, the Second Vatican Council's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy referred to the liturgy as the source and summit of Christian life. The source and summit. Right worship of God must be central in our lives if our approach to divine worship is to be rightly ordered. And if our approach to divine worship is not rightly ordered, then that disorder trickles into every other arena of our lives. So throughout this talk, I'll draw on sacred scripture, sacred tradition, and the sacred magisterium, that is the church's teaching body, to ascertain what a rightly ordered approach to sacred music should look like. I further hope to relate this to matters of faith, morals, and other facets of Christian life, kind of emphasizing again that music's not just something that kind of happens in isolation from the rest of Christian life. Now, let's start with a central and fundamental facet of Catholic teaching, namely the Incarnation. That is, the belief that God Almighty assumed human flesh in the person of Jesus Christ. Each Sunday, we say in our creed that for us men and for our salvation, Christ came down from heaven, and that by the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For us men and for our salvation. My friends, this is a pure motive of love on God's part. We rejected his first attempt at love in the Garden of Eden, and he sought to repair the breach. Now, being omnipotent, he could have done that any number of ways. We even heard a little bit about this in one of the, I believe, the 12th meditation on the stations tonight. But the way he chose was not an easy one. He chose to leave his glorious throne in heaven, to come suffer on earth, beginning with the wood of the manger and culminating his death and torment on the wood of the cross. Becoming human was not convenient as a solution on God's part. Nevertheless, he took human flesh to make himself known to us. God made us sensual beings who glean information about things in the natural world by means of sight, hearing, smell, touch, and taste. Even the supernatural things are made known to us through our senses, as St. Paul says, letter to the Romans, he says, quote, ever since the creation of the world, God's invisible attributes of eternal power and divinity have been able to be understood in what he has made. And think about it. How many times have we seen an ocean, a canyon, some majestic sight, and we the material world, stuck in these bodies which would be sinful. This Gnostic understanding of the human person is inherently contradictory to the Christian doctrine of the Incarnation, if you think about it. After all, if we believe as Christians that Christ saved us from our sin specifically by taking on human flesh and becoming like us in all ways but sin, how can we then say that in taking on flesh, he somehow became evil? Insofar as Jesus' human nature was concerned, it was perfectly conformed to the perfect will of his heavenly Father. We believe that in the person of Jesus Christ, our humanity was elevated. However, this could not really be possible for the Gnostic. For the Gnostic, Christ's incarnation could not be understood to elevate our humanity. All the Gnostic could understand is that that somehow diminishes his divinity. Now, you might at this point be rightly wondering, why all this musing on Gnosticism and the talk about sacred music? What does it have to do with sacred music? I guess my short answer would be basically everything. The very existence of a sacred art or music tradition in the church hinges on the very point in question. If the Catholic Church bought into Gnostic belief, we would understand that the whole material world surrounding us is evil. We might further be led to believe that our senses, having contact only with the evil of the material world, are nothing but deceptive. I could be seeing that a clock says something, but it's in fact useless to be seeing that because it could just be pure deception. Furthermore, if we take that tack with art and music, we could understand that at best it would be morally neutral, but in all likelihood it would probably be evil because it's just distracting us or in some way kind of drawing us again into the evil of the material world, so to speak. Now, the reason that the Catholic tradition is cultivated an artistic tradition is that we do not believe that the material world, pardon me, is evil. And we do not believe that our senses are deceptive by default. Now, it's true. We can't completely deny that most of the famous sins committed throughout history have involved the senses. We think of maybe alcoholism, drug abuse, sex abuse, any number of sins that the temptation of which comes to us through the flesh. Still, these occasions of sin that come through the senses are not in and of themselves sinful, nor can they make the material world intrinsically evil. On a practical level as well, we can think about many sins that we commit aren't visible on the outside, aren't even viewable by the senses. For example, sins of the Holy Spirit, the greatest of all sins, despair, hatred, presumption, resistance of a known truth, envy of spiritual goods, and final impenitence. These are the absolute gravest sins we can commit, yet they don't take any visible outward form, right? So yes, material things can in fact be an occasion for sin, but so can immaterial things. Another facet of Catholic theology that concerns us in the tradition of sacred art concerns the fall of Adam. Now let's again address an opposing view, kind of play devil's advocate again, before getting into the heart of the matter. A common misconception of the effects of the fall has come to be known, especially in Protestant circles, as total depravity of the will. Now according to this view, which again we do not buy into as Catholics, we're completely incapable of discerning the good, and we're completely incapable of choosing the good, following God, or refraining from evil. We're essentially helpless against the devil. That said, according to Catholic tradition, even after the fall, we are capable of discerning the good. We are capable of choosing the good and resisting evil. That said, it's quite a bit harder for us now than it once had been. As the Catechism of the Catholic Church puts it, through the fall of Adam, our intellects became darkened and our wills became weakened. I'll repeat that. Our intellects became darkened and our wills became weakened. And while it's true, our intellects were darkened, our wills were weakened, they weren't snuffed out altogether. Our wills were weakened, but they can still be trained. That's the point of fasting and other kind of physical exercises that we take on in life, right? And with the help of grace, particularly the grace of the sacraments, we can still choose to good and commit to doing it. Yes, we experience temptation, but that's not sin solution here is not simply to numb them or blindfold ourselves. Rather, it's to permeate them by means of our intellects to the things that will lead us to God. God himself created us as sensual beings. He desired to make himself known to us through the created order, through our five senses. Though he's invisible in his essence, he seeks to reveal himself to us through the things that we can see, hear, taste, smell, and touch. In the book of Hebrews, the virtue of faith is defined as the realization of what is hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. That is to say, while the object of our faith we might not see yet, it's nevertheless real. Although we as finite beings cannot see God in the fullness of his glory, we know that he is real because he has revealed reflections of this glory in the realm of our senses, in what he has created. We know of him through his mighty deeds in the Old Testament, through the sending of his Son, Jesus Christ, in the New Testament, and through his continued sacramental presence among us under the outward appearance of bread and wine. That's why we adore the Eucharist and sing hymns and use incense. Because God seeks to reveal himself to us in a physical incarnational form, our faith in him should take an outward and tangible incarnational form as well. That is why, as we learned last week, it's important to proclaim the word of God out loud. You know, preach the gospel and when necessary use words, but words are always necessary, Matt told us. The need for faith to take outward and visible form is summed up quite nicely in a passage in the Epistle of St. James. He says, "What is good, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister has nothing to wear and has no food for the day, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, keep warm and eat well,' but you do not give them the necessities of the body, what good is it? So also, faith of itself, if it does not have works, is dead." Before continuing on this thought, let me make a quick important clarification. We as Catholics do not believe, nor have we ever believed, that we can be saved somehow by our own good works. Even the most noble deed in the history of humanity couldn't possibly repair the breach that the sin of Adam brought about, were it not for Christ's atoning sacrifice. Now, our understanding of James' words should not be understood in such a manner that pits our faith against our works. It's the Catholic case of both and here. We have faith, we have works, and their relationship to each other. How so? Works should be understood as outward manifestations of an inwardly held faith. They're outward manifestations of an inwardly held faith. Our corporal works of mercy and other good deeds are an incarnational, visible, tangible expression of our faith. And any person sincere in their faith will wish to express it somehow. I mean, think of how you express love. If you never kiss your spouse, if you never hug your children, if you never tell them you love them, it's really hard for them to know. What kind of witness, then, do we as Catholics provide, for example, to staunch atheists, if we discuss doctrine at length, but then completely fail to care for the hungry and destitute in our midst, or even fail to notice them altogether? In short, it causes a type of scandal. People begin to understand our church as draconian and apathetic to the needs of the poor. But this is not the essence of our faith. If we provide the right kind of witness, people will understand our faith correctly. What we do outwardly, incarnationally, matters. True faith cannot remain a disembodied intellectual concept. It needs to take form in reality. This, my friends, leads us to the very reason the church has cultivated an artistic tradition. We need to make the goodness of our faith known in concrete, sensible form. God has revealed to us in the sensible realm and wishes to draw us to himself through the senses. In order to discuss the church's artistic tradition, we have to first consider the church's definition of beauty. In the words of our times, the word beauty is often thrown around flippantly, kind of to mean pretty things, nice things, ornamental extras, things that aren't really concrete form, makes contact with our senses, and draws us to something that is good and true. So again, Christ took visible human form to show forth the beauty of an invisible God. Similarly, the church seeks to tell forth the glory of God and his saving power through concrete beauty. It is for this very reason that we have Gothic cathedrals, sculptures, music, paintings, and elegant rituals. None of these things are to be loved as ends in themselves or as just pretty things, but rather they should show forth the splendor and omnipotence of God Almighty. Now, because the goodness and truth of God are so unsurpassing grandeur, we have to take care when we endeavor to reflect them in tangible form through the sacred arts. That very word sacred refers to something set apart, and in this case, devised for use in divine worship. Because sacred art is designated for such a noble purpose, the church's attitude toward it is not something that anything goes or do whatever you wish. Rather, it needs to be noted that some works of art, while religious in their content, still aren't suitable for use in the church's liturgies. For example, some paintings of biblical scenes may be very thought-provoking, may be very well suited for use in a home or gallery, but they're still not necessarily conducive to use in church. Similarly, for any of you opera buffs out there, Richard Strauss's opera Salome is actually based on a true biblical story. That said, it's heavily operatic music style, and its storyline that's kind of dominated by murder, lust, and a lot of warped psychology hardly makes it appropriate for use in worship. So while it is true that all sacred art must be religious in nature, it's conversely not the case that anything that's religious in its content qualifies as sacred art. Now, having discussed beauty in the church's artistic tradition at large, let's focus in specifically to sacred music now. Music that is sacred, you know, set aside for something, for use in the liturgy, ought to tell us something about what the liturgy is. And unfortunately, what the liturgy is has been no small source, of confusion and misunderstanding throughout certainly the last several decades and maybe even a number of centuries. You know, Catholics and Protestants all too well know about worship wars, in which the sacred liturgy or the worship of God is kind of reduced to an object of personal preference rather than understood as a God-given tradition. This, to me, summons to mind a story. I was playing a recital in a large urban Presbyterian church, and I was walking down the social hall and came to an intersection. The wall say, with a left-hand sign saying traditional service, and a right-hand sign saying contemporary service. So here we have members of one church going to separate worship services that are taking simultaneously on the basis of a divided preference of worship style. That's not unity in Christ, my friends. So, if a reinvigoration of sacred music and liturgy is to take place in our local, national, or universal church, we absolutely have to overcome this misguided notion that the liturgy is merely an object of personal preference. Christ is and must be the central protagonist. When we obscure this reality, when we try to make humanity the center of the liturgy, we, in essence, make the liturgy less of what it is intended to be. Now, following the Second Vatican Council, a number of misinterpretations of the Sacred Council's documents led to kind of a heightening of personal preference and threatening of Christ from being the center of the liturgy. Rather, kind of focusing the liturgy around the community as a whole, or perhaps the persona of an individual. Mind you, when I say this happening following the Second Vatican Council, this is not something espoused by the Second Vatican Council. It's something that, if anything, was contrary to the council, but not I can't imagine any army that was too good at following commands from their superiors. So it's really confounding that that priests had been chided for doing exactly what they were instructed to do, and rightly instructed to do. So while many of these individuals creating subjectivity in the liturgy may have been doing so in a well-intentioned manner, or perhaps even with a misunderstanding of what was expected of them, what's at stake here is the universality and objectivity of the liturgy. What's at stake is Christ being the protagonist, the center of the liturgy. When we threaten that, the liturgy entirely becomes disoriented in its identity. And in the same way that celebrating the Holy Mass became subjective to personal preference, we shouldn't be surprised that the same also happened with sacred music. Both of these remedies must be addressed, but in order to do so, we need to reestablish sacred liturgy is a gift that has been given to us by God in the person of Jesus Christ and through his church. Our attitude toward the liturgy has been generative for too long. That is, we think of it as something that we have to make. We have to make it happen. We have to instead view it from a receptive lens. We have to inherit it. We have to receive it. And we have to execute it according to the inherited tradition of the church. And while our need to reclaim Christ as the center of the liturgy today is real, I don't want to mislead you into thinking this is something unique to our era in history. The crisis of sacred music in particular, being ignored this way by personal preference or societal events, has been going on for centuries. And in fact, I'd like to dive into the magisterial documents of the church by paying heed to a document that sought to address this exact issue at the dawn of the 20th century. So in 1903, there's a cardinal living in Venice by the name of Giuseppe Sarto, who's elected as Pope Pius X. And his papacy in its era was beset by many challenges due to a lot of rapid societal changes brought about by modern thought, the Industrial Revolution, kind of the still, in grand terms, relatively new idea of democracy, and in the Vatican, the dissolution of the papal states had a lot of kind of implications for what the papacy meant. And there were a lot of wars going on in the European continent as well. The world was spinning around, and Pius X's first papal encyclical could have really tackled any number of pressing issues. But what he tackled first was sacred music. This might be shock us. It might seem trivial to us that because we've all been directly or indirectly affected by the idea that beauty is simply, again, pretty niceties. But Pius tackled it because he realized that it was of great importance. And as I said before, if our approach to divine worship is poisoned, that toxicity bleeds into all other areas of Christian life. Now, writing this encyclical, we had to deal with a fundamental question. What is the purpose of sacred music? And he gives a very simple, twofold answer. He says, it is first for the glorification of God, and secondly, for the sanctification and edification of the faithful. So firstly, for the glorification of God, secondly, for the sanctification and edification of the faithful. The first facet of this definition, namely to give glory to God, should be obvious, but it's pretty easy to lose sight of, unfortunately. It's our duty to give glory to God. But even though it's our duty, and should be bereft of self-interest, right worship of God does, in a very sideways fashion, benefit us. One of the prefaces to the Mass, for example, states, the prayers before the Psalms, holy, 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 we hear that our praises have nothing to God's great So much for the glorification of God. Let's move on to the second facet of Pius's articulated purpose for the sacred music. The second facet is two-pronged, and it's related to the first. The first one, of course, being the glorification of God. But after that, there's the sanctification and edification. Sanctification, edification. And let's define those two terms separately here. The process of sanctification, as we've somewhat hinted to before, is simply the process of making something holy or set apart specifically for God. Again, since Catholics are people of the Incarnation, we seek this sanctification even through the senses. For example, these stunning stained glass windows and beautiful Stations of the Cross we are blessed to have here in St. Clement should draw us to the mysteries of God and that incense that was burning. Again, we associate that with church and with God. These should all remind us of the awesomeness of our Creator. And at times, the otherworldliness of this sacred liturgy might be an acquired taste. I'll never forget the first time I went to a Greek Byzantine church and was enamored of all the beautiful icons, the elegance of the rite, even the kind of otherworldly chanting, but I nevertheless kind of felt uneasy about it. Sometimes, even those things that are pleasant to us can be an acquired taste, and sometimes our process of sanctification can go along with being an acquired taste. So having discussed sanctification, let's turn to edification. Edification can be defined by Merriam-Webster as kind of a process of instruction and improvement, particularly with recourse to religious matters. And while it's not implicitly stated in this definition, the word edification tends to connote or imply a sense of pleasure or satisfaction. It's a pleasure that we ourselves tend to realize is superior to other types of pleasure. For example, listen to a very informative podcast, watched a great documentary, or maybe listen to one of Father Howe's awe-inspired homilies, you might have a great feeling of satisfaction that in a certain sense you know is superior to when you went home and binge-watched the whole season of The Office. Not that I've ever done that before. Sacred music really ought to edify a satisfaction. It should be beautifully crafted and executed, but it should also inform our intellects about heavenly things and bend our wills to pursue them. So now that we've discussed the purpose of sacred music, let's talk about the requisite qualities that flow from that. If it's going to be to effectively achieve the glorification of God, the sanctification and the edification of the faithful, how is it to do that? Pius identifies, again, three qualities. There's holiness, integrity of form, and universality. You can see those on your handout. Now, the quality of holiness, as we discussed just a bit ago, implies that a particular thing is set apart or consecrated for a particular purpose. For example, around a century ago, or maybe more than a century ago, Archbishop of Ireland consecrated this beautiful building in which we stand for public worship. And the faithful knew full well that it was for public worship and not a baseball diamond. Now, for sacred music to exhibit this holiness, Pius says it has to be free from profane association. And by profane here, we don't mean that something's evil in the sense that you tell your kid who just swore in a supermarket not to use profane language. Profane simply means something that's everyday but, again, doesn't belong, isn't consecrated for use in the temple. For example, in the realm of music, taking me out to the ballgame is not evil. But if I were to write a setting for the Gloria for Easter Sunday that used the tune of Take Me Out to the Ballgame, I would venture to say that your mind would be more on hot dog vendors, who's on first, and maybe what the umpire is going to do next instead of the resurrection of Christ. Simply put, the association is not the right one to bring. So following holiness is a quality. Pius then goes on to outline goodness or integrity of form. He states that sacred art must be true art, for otherwise it will be impossible for it to exercise on the minds of those who listen that efficacy which the Church aims at obtaining and admitting into her liturgy the art of musical sounds. To kind of sift through all that, it has to be good music. It can't be painful to listen to, and if it is painful to listen to, it probably won't succeed in drawing our hearts and minds to heaven. Now, for music to be good in itself, we have to consider two crucial components. Firstly, it must be well composed, and secondly, it must be well executed. Very often, mediocre and sometimes even bad compositions have been extolled. Great examples of liturgical music simply because, to some people's thinking, they exhibit kind of the aforementioned quality of holiness. They might sound churchy, but at the end of the day, they're not especially well-crafted and can fail to move the heart mind of the listener. The aforementioned quality of holiness, if it's going to take effect, has to happen within the framework of well-composed music. Luckily, the Church has centuries and centuries worth of well-composed music, spanning from Gregorian chant to music of the medieval. You go through even some substantial composers, Mozart, Beethoven, writing music for the Catholic liturgy, and there's still plenty being composed in our own day. That said, all of this well-composed music isn't going to go very far if it's not very well executed. If it's pain, again, if the most perfectly written piece of music is painful to listen to, it's not going to draw hearts and minds to God. Now, what's important is that we invest what's necessary to have music be well executed, but we should bear in mind that's going to differ on circumstances. What's going to happen in a large urban cathedral is going to be different than what happens in a small country church. We kind of think of the principle of the widow's mite here. What's important is that we're giving God our first fruits from this, that we're investing in it properly, that we're seeking to give glory to God in this fashion. So having discussed holiness and integrity of form, Pius' third and final quality is universality. And this quality is a little more challenging to wrap our minds around, perspective has become through, fast media, computers, the internet in the past century. It's a lot different than when Pius was writing. There are a lot of different musical aesthetics across the world, it's true. But in the same way that in our culture, something might qualify as sacred or profane, in any other culture with which the Church makes contact, there must be that same care that profane elements are not omitted. And while specifically how that's applied in each culture across the world is a fascinating topic, it would require a very long, probably series of talks to even get into it, so I'm not going to open that can right here. Luckily, Pius gave us kind of an example of holiness, integrity, and form and universality. Kind of a supreme model, and that is Gregorian chant. Which Gregorian chant is, in a manner of speaking, kind of the official language of the Catholic Church. And after Pius, 50 years or so after Pius, I guess 60 after Pius, the Second Vatican Council affirms this exactly, kind of saying it's to be given pride of place. I guess the reason I think it might be extolled as a model is because it's music that's entirely in the service of the sacred word. Each chant in this vast output of music is conceived with the intention of elevating the Word of God and implanting it more effectively on the hearts of those who hear it. And that is why it's elevated as a supreme model. So every composer who decides to take a pen to paper and set a sacred text needs to think deeply about what this text is saying before they write a single note. With every note written, the composer needs to be asking him or herself, how is this going to help implant the Word of God it going to draw admiration? Those aren't really the prime questions. The prime questions are, how is this going to drive the sacred word home more and more to God Almighty? While this music should be edifying, it should be pleasurable to listen to, it needs to draw us to reality beyond itself, and it needs to help prepare us for eternal life with God. If we hope to dwell with God in eternity, that is, outside the earthly confines of time, we must take care to sanctify our time while we exist here on earth. How we use the time God has given us here will have profound implications for how we experience the afterlife. As such, I would posit that one very important task of sacred music concerns the sanctification of time. Of all the so-called fine arts, music is, in a sense, the most well-disposed to sanctify time, precisely because it's a medium of art that exists and unfolds in time. Whether you're listening to someone sing Happy Birthday, a 3 to 5 minute song on the radio, or a 3 hour opera, you can't possibly take in a piece of music or sing a piece of music without time passing, right? In Christ, through his incarnation, sanctified time. His incarnation not only made him a human creature of flesh and blood, but insofar as his human nature was concerned, he became a being existing in time and affected by the passage of time. Our church's liturgical year with its shifting season is meant to help us sanctify time and understand more fully the arc of the salvation history. Each year we recall Christ coming in the flesh. Throughout Advent and Christmas, Christ coming in the flesh. In Lent, you know, we assume a posture of self-mortification to prepare us to enter into his passion and death. In Easter, we celebrate his resurrection from the dead and his ascension into glory and the sending of the Holy Spirit. And of course, throughout ordinary time, we recall Christ's teachings among his apostles. And ultimately, at the end of ordinary time, start to think about the four last things and anticipate Christ's second coming in glory. And sacred music and all of the other arts need to be deployed in such a manner that help us enter into each season. At present, or I should say at present, in about 48 hours, we're going to be in Passiontide. You'll know this because a lot of this purple cloth kind of starting to cover a lot of things around. And as we go there, we need to conform our hearts to Christ so as to share in his passion and cross. If we wish to imitate him and to console him in his sorrow and lamentation, we need to be conscious about observing this. Here in our own parish, we've sought to sanctify time during Passiontide the past couple of years by tapping into a time-honored tradition of the Church known as Tenebrae. The word tenebrae is derived from the Latin language and means darkness. Incidentally enough, this service is conducted in the dark. And on Good Friday, at 6:45 a.m. at Holy Cross, and we pray in a darkened church that recalls both the darkness of Christ's tomb as well as the darkness that fell over the earth as Christ was crucified at the hour of mercy. The sung service consists of many psalms and canticles of lamentation from the Old and New Testament that echo the sorrow Christ experienced in his own passion. The chanted texts will be complemented by the sorrowful but sweet choral responsories of Spanish Renaissance composer Tomás Luis de Victoria. These responsories, by the way, represent a great example of the qualities of sacred music discussed above. They're exquisitely crafted in every way, and the music is completely molded around the sacred texts that it sets. I have no doubt that in part this flows from a personal sanctity of Tomás Luis de Victoria, the composer, who was a Jesuit priest and a contemporary of such figures as St. John of the Cross and St. Teresa of Avila. And like both of these saints, he was thought to be something of a mystic, having a kind of essential glimpses into the divine mysteries. And from my own experience, after studying, rehearsing, and directing with these responsories, I've greatly come to appreciate how every fiber of the composer's being was invested in the passion of the Lord and how to best communicate. by saying that over the course of the evening's talk, we've discussed the importance of the doctrine of the Incarnation in the context of the Catholic faith. We've discussed the implications that this carries for sacred music. We've examined the role of sacred music, namely that it exists for the glorification of God and the sanctification and edification of the faithful. We further discussed the requisite qualities of holiness, integrity of form, and universality that should inform the cultivation of sacred music. And in all of this, we have sought to correct a misguided consumerist notion that would see sacred music merely as a form of entertainment. Let me conclude by reiterating that music in the sacred liturgy is not meant to be entertaining, but it is meant to be transformative. It is intended to draw our hearts and minds to the things of heaven, and to subsequently motivate us to reorder our lives, to ensure that we can one day be numbered among those present at that unending liturgy that's sung by the choirs of saints and angels. We are given many snapshots of this heavenly liturgy in the Book of Revelations, and most of them involve copious singing. Our singing in the liturgies here on earth can be understood as a sort of spiritual rehearsal in which we prepare our bodies and souls to sing eternally in the heavenly chorus. And that, my friends, is why what we sing matters. Everything in our liturgies, from the Word of God, the physical sanctuary of the church building, and the music we hear, must transform our hearts and order them for eternity with God in heaven. Thank you much for coming. I don't know that reception was to happen.